Hi guys, and welcome to IndieFix. In this week's episode, we're going to be talking about PR for indie games and how to get a successful PR campaign together before your indie game releases and to build that buzz around your indie game. I hope you enjoy the show. Cue the theme music. So hi guys and welcome. As I said before, we're discussing PR for indie games and how to build that successful campaign that you want. This week's episode is mainly adapted from an article from Gamasutra called Building Buzz for Indie Games. It's quite dated from 2009, but it really outlines the points that I want to discuss. And it's by Paul Taylor, who's the co-head for Mode 7 Games, who makes such games as Determinants and Frozen Synapse, which is a classic, by the way. I also will mention stuff from an indie game developer's marketing checklist, which includes a portable, all the stuff about portable formats, and I'll link that in the description below. And also, in terms of press kits, you can check out dopresskit.com, which is based off Rami Ismail's template for press pages on your website if for an indie dev. So let's get to it. The first thing that you need to focus on when you're building your PR campaign is the concept. Okay, so you already have a concept for your game that you want to propose via Kickstarter, whatever medium or way you choose to do it. This is what Paul Taylor says. One vast component of marketing is having a strong concept for your product. You should already be thinking about your audience when you start to create something. You necessarily have to do something that's popular, but you do have to consider about who your audience is. And this is what Paul Taylor also had to say in his take. There are commercially successful indie games about Ganley Kung Fu fighting rabbits, abstract computer landscapes populated by tiny green squeaking things, and small dribbly blobs of goo. These are never going to be as big as The Sims, this is an older reference, but they were never intended to be. By commercially successful, I mean making enough money for the creators to continue making games. That's your goal, right? Go for a popular concept only if you have a passion for it. You need passion to drive you through the process of making the game. If you're coming up with something wackier, realize that you're going to have to work harder to find the audience and start figuring out how you're going to go about doing that before you start development. And that's a really solid point that Taylor makes there. So one of the major things they mention in this article is that you have to set up your necessary blog and social media. If he even states here, if you're making a game, almost everything you do is newsworthy to someone. So if you've done some stimulating programming, some concept art, something, made some interesting music, or found an original way to promote your game, you need to get in touch with the community who care about this kind of game. And you'll need a website, a blog, a development blog, and you must get yourself out there. There's a very good quote from Jonathan Colton, who's an indie musician. He's worked with a lot of indie developers as a composer. The only way to start a blog is to pretend the audience is there, even if you think it's zero. The truth is, your friends will come and read it, and then it'll be your friends and some guy who lives in Cleveland. And the whole idea is to basically unite people in a community to support you. And really, social networking is also a very important part of any marketing campaign, any part of for PR. Another good point is that you must keep track of everything. You don't just keep pumping out information all the time. You need to set goals and you need to keep people consistently up to date with what you're doing. So if that's through your development blog, through video updates on YouTube, through your social media, through Twitter, which is a very good way of giving updates to people, or if you're on Steam Greenlight, through your Steam Greenlight page, keep those up to date because people appreciate that kind of stuff. So what is the first major stage in building buzz around your indie game? Well, according to Taylor, there's the announcement. So you'll probably be announcing your game when you have some content to show. He suggests doing this as early as possible. Example you could use is a piece of attractive concept art or a little bit of gameplay footage of a prototype, anything. And he says that you mustn't be dissuaded if news sources don't pick up on your stuff immediately, but if you release really good concept art, you can get a lot of sites' attention. The idea is to get out there and get people talking, and essentially you must make a good first impression and put out all sorts of content to see what picks up. Also, he says it's really important to know how to write a press release. When it comes to press releases, it's mostly common sense, and the whole point is to try and communicate simply. You need to include anything noteworthy about what you've done in the past, the history of your studio, or anything interesting that's vaguely associated with what you've done before. And the biggest step that anyone can do is to build a PR list. So if you find editorial contacts from, be it magazines, which is actually not that popular anymore, but anyway, websites like the one I work for, and blogs and the like, you have to be proactive in that engagement. And you have to engage edits contacts and journalists and people at meetups. You'll also need to make a press kit for your site, which is available through Rami Ismail, who's done a very good site called dopresskit.com. It's a template, or I think an HTML thing, for creating a press page that you can implement on your website. I think even WordPress you can do it. But essentially what a press kit consists of is your relevant screenshots, your videos like trailers, demonstrations, demos, etc., press coverage, a game information sheet, which could include a fact sheet about your game with links to your devlog, website, and social media accounts. You can have logos and awards there that you've won. And you must also disseminate those links to your press kit via social media so people and your followers can keep up a good discussion, because you want to have the discussion going and that social engagement going. The second stage is maintenance and momentum, according to Taylor. Now you have created a situation where some people are following your updates, he says. The time is now to capitalize on this. So he says you must release quality updates about everything you do with your game. These can be videos, pictures, audios, text, code, funny development stories, anything, so that you could even have updates via your Kickstarter if you're going that route. And you have to keep those constantly coming out. You have to respond to the community, talk to them, and invite new people. And you have to also be proactive in meeting with contacts, frequenting events and expos. That's what Make Games to Say does. They go to Rage and they actually get involved with the community. They have meetups, community meetups. People can go and see the games. That's the whole point. And in South Africa, that's what we're doing. And internationally, people can do that. They have game jams where you can come up with new prototypes. You can go to game development conferences like GDC and, you know, get involved. The third stage is basically previews and release hype. You have to go out actively and do previews of your game at events, you know, hands-on, show off the game to contacts via email that you've built up in your press list. Demonstrate the qualities of your game and give people an idea of what your game is about. You need to really encourage people via all these digital means, via social media, and get people to have a hands-on with your game and promote that. If your game is multiplayer, which is in stage 4, according to Taylor, is that you can have an open beta. You can test the game to its limit, have server stress, but a very good way of doing this is having Steam Early Access, and you can do testing through that where people pay to test a prototype of your game, because it's not a finished game, of course. For single player games, I see a lot of devs releasing demos on Kickstarter or via their Steam Greenlight page, or even via their web page with a Humble Widget. You know, when they use a Humble Widget, they can charge for early prototype of a game if they want to go that way. But generally, I think releasing free demos encourages people to pre-order your game and get on that sort of train of thought. The fifth stage is reviews, and this is really where I have experience. And I appreciate when a dev gets in touch with me and says A, B, and C about their game in a good press release and says, oh, here's a Steam code to review your game. It helps to foster a very good relationship with game and journalists from both small sites to bigger sites. And I think if you're a dev, you should appreciate smaller sites because they are the most hungry to get articles out and to show off talents as well. That's my feelings of it. You could disagree. But here's a point that Taylor makes. Unless you're already well known, there'll be a lot of opposition from major magazines, which is irrelevant now, but he also mentions websites to review your game. He says, build awareness early. If your game becomes trending like Braid or Fez, you'll stand a much better chance of being successful and getting better reviews. This is another reason that you get onto this conference and festival circuit. People will take you more seriously if you talk about your game. And really, he stresses that you must be early in setting out your PR. Talk to anyone who's given you a preview and push hard to get through the door of more obstructive places. And he says when you actually get to talk to journalists properly, like I've suggested, they will always tell you what they wished more indies would be doing, which is actually doing proper PR and making it easier for them to find out about interesting projects. And essentially what this does is it helps you to make you significant to game journalists, and you can just ask more questions. And I've seen a lot of devs recently, like Duncan Bell and the devs for Project Montez, Kubas van Vidi Vek, who have mentioned me and sent me tweets or direct messages, emails, and it really helps to foster a connection with people on the opposite side and helps you to make your games more prominently featured on sites. And also, I think, don't forget local websites from whichever country you're from, because those sites will be the best source for spreading news about your game. Finally, the last stage, the sixth stage, the home straight, no, you're on. Meaning, are you home? Are you at the final leg? He says, make a huge fuss on release of your game. You must do more press releases to your huge list of contacts, put out more videos, phone up everyone and tell them about your game. But he also says that really it's not the end of the line. You've got to be doing a post-release marketing campaign. Basically, this revolves around targeting web advertising, game updates, interviews. Like, I've had some guys contact me about interviews and a variety of other tools. Really, that is the essential thing you can do to be successful post-release. Because your game might be on Steam, but the problem with Steam is that there's not a lot of quality control. This has been an issue. So if your game is up on Steam and nobody knows about it, then how are you going to sell games? So essentially, updates are great. Sales, milestones are great. Also, be more proactive at events. Go and talk about your game. Put your game into competitions and festivals. He also mentions IGF and other indie competitions. So get involved in game jams, because even though you might be making a different prototype, you can tell other people about and other devs about your game, and if they have more followers, they can retweet your status updates, your tweets, I mean. And that's a great way of fostering to help you build up more people, more journalists interested in your game. And in the end, you can then be on the road to success. And I really hope this helps devs out. And if you've given a listen to this, I really thank you. And that brings this week's episode of Indie Fix to an end. I hope you guys enjoyed the show. Please leave a comment in the comment section below. Like us if you enjoyed the video. Or subscribe to our channel if you'd like to see more of our content. I hope you guys have a great weekend. And I wish you all the best. See you next time.